walk anywhere in Britain and you're literally stepping on history. Lost towns, forgotten people, vanished cultures all lie beneath our feet.
You can imagine what it would have been like 2,000 years ago.
But little by little, they're coming to the surface.
It's the first time this has appeared in 260 years.
Giving us a glimpse of how our ancestors once lived.
Oh, goodness me.
And helping us separate the myths and legends from historical facts.
I can feel the power in my hand.
I'm Alex Langland.
I've always got time for a bit of digging.
And I'm Raksha Dave.
Oh, look at that!
We're both archaeologists. And in this series, we'll be diving into the past, coming face to face with the extraordinary.
It is holding a piece of history in your hands, isn't it?
And along the way, we'll be uncovering the secrets that have remained hidden underground for centuries.
I just want them to dig faster. Keep going, troops, keep going.
...1914, and the most devastating conflict the world had ever known. Trenches, tanks, and troops.
About 8 million people from across the British Empire served in the First World War. Alongside them on the front lines were other largely forgotten heroes, the country's war horses.
And around 1 million of those brave animals were involved. Carrying troops and supplies, hauling heavy weaponry, even leading the charge into battle. And as with their human comrades, the deaths and casualties were appalling. Over 250,000 fell on the Western Front alone.
Many of the horses that saw action would have spent time in places like the site that is the location for our latest dig.
The British Army's Catterick Garrison is in North Yorkshire, between Leeds and Newcastle. Following the outbreak of World War I, a huge complex of stable blocks and a horse hospital were built here to prepare the animals for their journey to the front line. Over a century on, nearly all the buildings have been lost to the soil. But now, archaeologists and military veterans are trying to uncover them. I'll be joining them in their search. But first, I need to speak to the man giving the orders.
What do we know about the horse barracks here?
They're built as part of the First World War takeover of the garrison. There's talk, or at least we've seen a reference to them, for something like enough stabling for 40,000 horses.
40,000? Then we're dealing with quite a substantial complex here, aren't we?
Oh, yeah, it's massive.
This is a big old area, all covered with stable blocks, yards, all
That's
to
right.
do with...
All the tack houses, everything that they're using to basically just to keep these horses trained and looked after. And these trenches, the three that we've opened, are literally keyhole surgery, given the size of the place.
So this is a lost episode of Britain's history here, immediately beneath our feet.
If historical records are to be believed, directly beneath this field lies a vast complex of stable buildings. The task of scraping back the centuries' worth of soil falls to a unique group of diggers.
This is what we call an Operation Nightingale excavation. So it's been run by professional archaeologists.
Yep.
We've also got some veterans as well who've come through Help for Heroes, Band of Brothers. And this is one of the things we use in archaeology as a pathway towards their recovery. And also it's great for them because they're working on what are military sites. So this is conflict archaeology. Yeah, it literally speaks to them from that point of view as well.
Yeah, but of course, we're not going to get it excavated just standing around chatting, so perhaps I should get my hands dirty. Have you got a tool I can use?
I certainly got a mattock with your name on it.
Great, excellent.
Could 40,000 horses have really passed through this site? And how were they fed, trained, looked after and transported to the front? The next 2 weeks should reveal the answers.
Although we no longer use horses in battle, they're still very much a part of the British military. Today, there are 13 cavalry regiments in the army, and none more prestigious than the monarch's own troop, the Household Cavalry.
Or to give them their official title, Her Majesty the Queen's Lifeguard.
The cavalry's troops and horses have been performing daily ceremonial duties for centuries. Their traditional, flamboyant uniforms have always caught the eye.
As far back as the 19th century, one satirist did joke, "Oh, pantaloons of cherry, oh, brighter than a raspberry, for men to fight in things so tight. Must be trying, very."
But appearances can be deceiving. These riders and their equine ancestors have always been the ultimate fighting machines. In August 1914, the first British shot in World War I was fired by a cavalry corporal. But their distinguished record stretches back much further.
Hello, Pete.
Hi, Rasha.
You've got this great reputation for being very effective in battle, haven't you, the Household Cavalry?
Our first battle honour is the Royal Dragoons Battle Honour from Tangier, 1661. We were at Dettingen and we were at Waterloo and we were in Egypt and we were in the Boer War, the First World War, the Second World War. So, yes, we've had a fine fighting record over the years.
How important has the role of the British cavalry been throughout history?
I don't think you can underestimate how important the role of cavalry was. Bear in mind that the horse gave commanders a higher viewpoint. It gave the ability to move formed bodies, as I say, from point A to point B. It gave the ability to put in charges against enemy cavalry when they were coming forward, as at Waterloo. It gave the opportunity to pursue defeated soldiers.
In the First World War, the horses also had a crucial logistical role.
You've got to look at the moving things behind the lines as well. Got a 400-mile front from the North Sea to Switzerland, which is trenches and barbed wire and machine guns, etc. But behind the lines, on both sides, there's a huge infrastructure. Huge, enormous infrastructure where they're moving everything. Mail, rations, and virtually everything was horse-drawn.
Over the course of the war, up to 1,000 horses were shipped to Europe every day. The army literally moved on horseback, and fighting the enemy simply wouldn't have been possible without them.
It was from our site at Catterick that many of those horses began their journey to the front line. Although today, the clues to their presence are firmly below ground.
There's a handful of bricks here, handful of stones, but we're also getting this sort of other material, this kind of sort of aggregate-y material. So I'm beginning to wonder whether we've got some other material that's been brought in to make up the ground here so that it can support a pasture, support this grass that can then feed the horses here. So there's question marks about what this material is, but one thing is for certain, underneath it lies our First World War stable block.
It's still early days in the dig, and there's a lot of rubble to get through, but some evidence of military activity is starting to surface. Evidence that's instantly recognisable to this veteran serviceman.
Steph found this.
Right.
And she handed it to me, and there was some writing on it. And do you know what that stands for?
Well, I can see Institute.
Institute. That's the Navy, Army and Air Force Institute, or NAFI.
The NAFI?
Anybody who's in the military would know what the NAFI is.
Right.
It's basically a canteen where you would go and have your chip butties or your egg butties and your tea and what have you. And that, I suspect, possibly, because of the shape of it, I think that's actually the edge of a saucer.
As the NAFI wasn't formed till the 1920s, this broken crockery wasn't trampled on by World War I horses. More likely, it was dropped during the stable's demolition. Still, it's a start and an unexpected memento for the veteran diggers.
So does that bring back some memories for you then,
seeing
that?
Yeah. Certainly does. Yep.
You must have stared at that a few times in your life.
I've drank out of teacups with that a few times.
Yes, definitely.
Next, the ground does begin to give up its equine treasures.
So we've got a leather strap.
Right, oh, excellent.
With a copper alloy buckle.
And I learn about the jobs Catterick's war horses might have been expected to do, including the most dangerous.
Everything we do is taken from battlefield movements that were used in time gone by.
Catterick Catterick Garrison in North Yorkshire. It's the biggest British Army base in the world, housing 13,000 soldiers. But 100 years ago, their military predecessors had company. Alongside them were an army of war horses being prepared for frontline action. Today, archaeologists and military veterans are searching for lost evidence of the World War I stables that lie beneath this field. And they're making progress. So I've just found out we've got a really exciting find that's turned up in Trench 1. So, Steph, Jamie, what have you got for me then?
So we've got a leather strap.
Right, oh, excellent.
With a copper alloy buckle.
Right. That is lovely. Can I have a hold of that?
Yeah, go ahead.
So this is almost certainly to do with saddlery, harness.
Yeah, we're thinking so, yeah.
So what's great here is we're getting material, we think, from the active life of the stables here.
Yeah.
Most probably.
Yeah.
Our first victory, getting us closer to just one of the horses stationed here before its journey to the battlefield. But as records show, there were thousands of them. So how did the army accommodate them all?
I've actually got the plan here of the stables as they were built. Right, you can see on here what we've got is the upstanding structure behind us.
Over there, yeah.
Yeah, which is used by the Saddle Club.
Right.
We've also got here this barn building.
Right, that's...
Which is that.
That's a barn over
that's
there.
That's the one, the barn
okay,
there.
OK, so that's that. Excellent. So we're sort of stood roughly down here in the dung heap.
That's right.
Very fitting.
Yeah, indeed. And what you can see spreading out in front of us on this plan, you've got these lines of stables coming all the way along here. And these are stretching out way over into where the trees are.
Yeah.
And it gives you just that whole idea of how big the thing was and
just
what is happening here.
What a huge operation it is. Yeah. The scale of these stables really is reflecting the scale of that war.
Absolutely. Yeah, yeah.
This is 1914. This is preparing for the biggest war in Britain's history.
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
When that war arrived in 1914, the British Army had just 25,000 horses at its disposal. Just as it needed more men, it needed more animals. In both cases, there was only one way to boost recruitment quickly: conscription.
The Army Remap Department traveled the country with documents like this. His Majesty, having declared that a national emergency has arisen, the horses and vehicles enumerated below are to be impressed for the public service. Grief-stricken families wrote to the War Office asking for their beloved animals to be spared. But if the army found them fit for purpose, they were forced to surrender them.
Animals used to pulling ploughs in the country or cabs in the city became war horses. Within a matter of weeks, 120,000 of them were called into service. But even that number was insufficient. Hundreds of thousands more were shipped in from the likes of North America, Canada and Australia, at risk from disease and enemy warships. Those who made it here were quickly put to work.
Some were used to pull carts to carry heavy equipment. Others had riders that were carrying messages to the front line. And some could be doing something like this.
This is a practice session for a ceremonial event. But during World War I, this unit, known as the King's Troop, would have taken these requisitioned horses quite literally into the firing line.
These horses would have been doing those types of manoeuvres whilst shells were going off and there was artillery fire.
So it's so incredible how quickly horses can adapt to these things. And you see it even now when we sort of bring a horse into London, they start going out on the road and see a big scary red bus and they'll sort of shy away. And then after a few weeks, they get very conditioned, very used to it, and will sort of go past as if it's nothing new. And I imagine that would have probably been the same sort of the First World War. You know, there were very, very skilled riders initially having to bring them on as they were sort of going into their first conflicts, as it were. But as things time went by, they'd find it a lot easier.
During the war, the Royal Horse Artillery, as it was first called, played a crucial role on the battlefield, positioning the guns.
Everything we do is taken from battlefield movements that were used in time gone by. the guns being taken in and out of action, hooked on and hooked off the horses, exactly what would have been done. So the horses would have travelled up with the cavalry in direct support, and as the cavalry were engaging the enemy, would have dropped the guns off and then engaged.
And as for the guns, they're not replicas.
They are the real deal. All of the guns were action in the First World War. The oldest was made in 1904, and the youngest is 1914.
With horses in the ranks, the army could put their guns into position quicker. And when they needed to, those animals could strike fear into the heart of the enemy.
Blimey, having like 50 horses charging towards you, it's quite an incredible experience. And actually, it's quite formidable as well.
Back at the dig, the team are beginning to discover building footings, tantalising evidence of the lost stables.
You're getting these as well, these like floor bricks. So we're coming down through the demolition layer here quite successfully, and we're finding these fantastic floor bricks, which have this wonderful blue colouring, which we think comes from a local steel industry, and the byproducts are used to make these bricks. And you can imagine the hooves of all of the horses that use this stable passing over these fantastic bricks.
It's exciting stuff, but not all the secrets of this place are to be found under the soil. Some of the horse buildings are still standing, and I'm told that these, currently the base for the Garrison Saddle Club, once made up the animal infirmary. Well, I've done my bit of digging, so now it's time to turn detective.
This is all looking good for early 20th century building construction, both in terms of the type of brick, but also the type of bonding that's being used here. But here we are, ha. The word pharmacy, this is looking promising. Hello, Phil.
Hello, Alex.
Hi, good to see you. You well?
Yeah, I'm good. How are you?
Yeah, very good. Now, am I right in thinking that you've got an original set of buildings here?
Yeah, I think we can think that. What we've got is this plaid, fantastic plaid.
We'll get some kind of idea about how the horses are being treated here just by looking at the arrangement of buildings.
Exactly, because this plan is pretty detailed and it's labelled, which depicts the use of some of the rooms.
Useful. Great. OK, so where should we start?
I think just over here would be a good start. That says colic and operation box.
Colic, right. And what I understand from colic is it's a form of sort of gut ache and gut pain, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right. Shall we go inside it?
So this is all original, this, then?
If a horse does fall over or falls to the ground with colic, it needs to get up quickly, and that the colic box will have sloping walls,
right,
which the horse can push against.
Oh, yes, yeah.
Can you see that? Very slightly sloping. It's almost smooth.
It is, isn't it? From what is in effect I haven't seen 100 years of use. Right, so the slinging room. Right, so what's the, what do we mean by slinging room, then?
Horses who had a broken leg, say.
Yep.
And we're recovering from that.
Yep.
They clearly can't put all their weight onto that.
Right.
So here, a sling would be put underneath the belly of the horse.
Yeah.
And that sling would go over the RSJ that we see in the roof over there.
Right.
And it would sort of hoist, would just take some weight.
Yeah.
You know, the load-bearing weight off the leg.
In some senses, it's almost sort of one-on-one, purpose-built rooms for the everyday conditions that the horses would have confronted.
Alongside the plan, it's the small, inconspicuous architectural features that tell us a huge story about what was happening here during the war.
This room is marked as a forage room.
So are we looking at a range of buildings here which is dispensing medicines, and therefore you've got a safe to keep things like opiates for the horses in here? You're mixing it in with your forage. I mean, taken together, we're looking at really quite a sophisticated range of buildings, all to deal with keeping a large stable's worth of horses up and running.
If these horses were going to the to battle, they could be lifesavers.
Yeah, yeah.
For so their owners.
They had to be in great shape.
Yeah, and I think that probably is the raison d'etre for this whole establishment, isn't it, for the infirmary.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's getting your horses in absolute ship shape so that you can get them out in the front and they can do the job that there's going to be, inevitably, is going to be asked of them.
No, that works for me, definitely, yeah.
In the relative safety of North Yorkshire, the well-being of horses appears to have been high on the military agenda. But once they reached the battlefield, keeping them fit and healthy was challenging, especially as many troops had never handled them before.
Belinda, I'm looking forward to seeing all of this stuff.
Fantastic.
At the National Army Museum stores, they still have the literature given to soldiers with no horse experience.
The Blue Cross, which were known as our Damned Friends League at the time, they issued a manual to help them look after their horses. I mean, it is very basic, and I mean, that's the sort of thing that today they would use at pony clubs to teach children the points of the horse.
Manual in hand, troops were also given tools to look after their new four-legged comrades.
This is a hoof pick, and it's designed for getting all the dirt and the mud and the stones out of your horse's hooves. Stones can penetrate the horse's sole of their foot and cause abscesses, which makes them go lame, so they can't be used. And they can also get a horrible infection called thrush,
but in
the soles of their feet, which causes their feet to rot away. So
it's a bit like, it is the trench foot equivalent for horses.
It is indeed, yes. So keeping the horse's feet clean, very, very important.
What is this?
So this is a nose bag for making sure that they don't waste any feed or fodder, so nothing gets spilled. The British Army actually believed in having quite fat horses out on the front because they believed fat horses would maintain condition better. So they lost about half as many horses on the Western Front as the French did because the French had these leaner, thinner horses that couldn't cope with the conditions that they were exposed to. Because these guys are basically carting around 21 stone worth of soldier and equipment.
So what I'm getting from these objects is that it's really important to look after your horse because
yes.
It's an essential piece of kit.
Yeah, it very much is. I mean, to the army, if your horse isn't sound, it's lame, it's in the hospital, it's a liability. They probably do look after their horses better than they look after the men, just because the horses cost them money.
If a horse did fall ill or was injured, expert care was on hand. 80% of those treated by the Army Veterinary Corps recovered sufficiently to be sent back into service and onto the front line. But there was no room for sentimentality, as one of the museum's exhibits reminds us.
This is a farrier's axe, and it dates to the 1820s, but it was actually used during the First World War as well. And as an archaeologist, I think this is a beautifully crafted piece of history. But actually, it also has a gruesome tale attached to it as well. When a horse was severely injured and there was no hope for it anymore, this spike was used to kill the horse as humanely as possible. And then the axe was used to chop off the end of the hoof, and not just any old hoof, the hoof that was stamped with the regiment's number. And that was there to account for how many animals that had been killed and to prove that such a valuable asset as a horse wasn't captured by the enemy.
Back at the excavation, and the team are working hard to uncover the elusive stable blocks. Elsewhere on the Cataract garrison, I'm continuing to find clues as to how the horses that came here were readied for battle.
I've been struck by this building here. I think this is the barn where all the fodder and the forage would have been stored for feeding all of these horses. And there are a few telltale signs. First off, you've got this large iron rail which runs across the top of this huge doorway. This would have supported iron closing doors, but it's all been bricked up. There's some more evidence inside as well. Now, the first thing we see is this paved floor, which is making its way from that doorway across the building to what would have been another set of huge double doors. And this whole arrangement is telling us that this was an important place for bringing the feed in. Very heavily laden wagons pulled by horses would be bringing products from the local farms and from the fields here for storage and processing. And let's face it, an army famously marches on its stomach, and horses were no different.
A horse requires 10 times more food than the average soldier. But, like their human companions, they were subject to rationing.
Horses were given, on average, around 20 pounds of feed per day. And that's about a fifth less than what we would expect to feed a horse in the present day. But it's this kind of stuff. This is a modern feed here that we've got. But here you can see ground barley and ground oats. That's the kind of stuff that the horses were being fed, both here and on the Western Front. And it really does underscore the importance of the horse to the British war effort by the fact that more of this stuff was shipped out to the Western Front than was ammunition.
Coming up, how the heroism of those horses captured the hearts of the nation and how one is still remembered today.
This is Warrior. According to my grandfather, he won the war single-handed.
Catterick in North Yorkshire. Today, the British Army base here is home to 13,000 troops. But a century ago, it also housed thousands of military horses, all bound for the battlefields of World War I. The stables and training facilities that once filled these fields are long gone. But now, a team of archaeologists and military veterans are scraping back the soil, finding clues as to how important to the war effort these animals were.
Hello, Alex. How's it going?
Hi, Alex. It's going very well, thank you very much.
So you've got some developments here then in Trench 2?
Yes, we certainly have. You can see here, I've just been looking at these sets.
Yeah, yeah.
We've got lots of these. These are probably used for floor surface. What you can also see is we've got a couple of these bricks as well.
Yeah.
These are just your normal common garden house bricks.
Yep.
We were expecting to find a lot more of these.
Right.
And as it turns out, we haven't. We're so far out of this trench, we've got a lot more sets than bricks.
Yeah.
And we now have got these lumps of concrete that are set in place. Yep. Looks as though it might have square mould around it, so it looks like a post has been set into it.
Right.
Most likely a wooden post, which is leading us to think that we thought these stables were brick-built. They're probably wooden built, which completely turns it on the head. They're obviously thrown up pretty quickly.
So this is actually telling us a story that's perhaps more urgent. 1914, outbreak of war, the speed with which they're having to recruit or require horses for the war effort is reflected in the types of structures they're needing to build.
The British Army are using, what, tens of thousands of horses at the start of the war for their logistics. That has to be increased when you're increasing the size of the army.
Good, well, it's good. It's good. I'm really pleased it's got interesting.
Yeah, me too.
Britain's lightning-fast preparations for the 1914-1918 war clearly had a huge effect, not only on Catterick's horse complex, but on the garrison as a whole.
I've got some copies of some old Ordnance Survey maps on my phone here, and they're brilliant for just demonstrating how much this landscape changed as a consequence of the First World War. So this map here was published in 1913, and you know, it's all just fields, but we then fast forward on a decade and look at the change. It's really quite remarkable. We've got a whole set of barracks popping up here, rifle ranges, and there, of course, is our stable block. I'm stood roughly next to that barn just there. The sick horse lines are over there and our stables are in front of us. And this is an amazing illustration for me of just how profound the impact of the First World War was on this landscape. Catterick, a part of the world that has gone on to become the biggest British military base in the world.
The military training of horses may be a thing of the past at Catterick, but it still continues at other army bases. I'm at the King's Troops Stables, currently home to 120 of the military's finest four-legged recruits.
This is where you work on a daily basis?
Yeah, this is all of F-Sub's horses in these lines.
And the design of this hasn't changed for a century, has it?
No, so this is like a modern version from World War I. We come in at 7 o'clock, they all get mucked out, and then they all get ridden every day apart from a Sunday, which is their day off.
How important is it for you to get that bond with the horses?
Very important, as they look after you every single day. So we've got two remounts in at the minute that have been good as gold, letting you put the harness on, the sword, everything. Then you get some that aren't really fit for the job, because some of them are good in civvy street, but not good for military life.
Each horse goes through an intense 3 months of training before being introduced to the military world here in Woolwich. Only those that meet the standard will then be given a role in the ceremonial gun team.
So which one is your favourite horse then?
This one here, this is Zelda.
Hello Zelda, how are you?
She's a leader in gun team. just because she's a bit more bigger compared to some of the more chunky ones that will be and will, but they've all got different jobs.
As well as preparing Zelda and the other horses for their duties, the team have to maintain the all-important tack room.
This is all the harness, it will all get put together, and that's what goes on the horses when they're in gun team.
You really have to look after it, don't you?
Yeah, it gets cleaned after every use and polished, and it's not just to make it look nice, it's to check for safety as well, making sure stitching hasn't come out, because obviously that can be dangerous if it's broken, especially when you've got six horses pulling.
Do you have so many people trying to polish all of this kit every day? But if you're in the middle of a battle, the upkeep of all of that kit's going to be immense.
Yeah, I can imagine. It'd be quite difficult, like living in a trench with all the mud and everything.
That mud meant it could take up to 12 hours to clean the war horses and their harnesses. But it was an essential job, preventing the equipment injuring the animals as they hauled those massive 1.5-ton guns across the battlefield.
Back at the dig, and the team have a cleaning task of their own to complete. Veterans Patches and Paula are polishing up some of the objects that have been unearthed so far.
So this is the epicentre of the fines processing, is it?
Yeah, this is where they let us loose cleaning it.
What sort of things are you getting?
Glass, lots of pottery, lots of tile, lots of metalwork.
Right, yes, I can see there's some pretty big lumps of metalwork here. These things are feeling to me like they could be part of water troughs, cast iron water troughs. As we know, we've got feeding troughs in and around the stables.
Yeah.
And I just imagine at that time they would have been made from metal. I like that, that's nice. This thing here, what do you think about this thing?
Well, there's a discussion of whether that would have held any of the tackle.
Right.
Bridles, tackle. Yeah. It's heavy enough so it'd take the weight of quite a lot.
Well, I'm pretty sold on that, Paula. I have to say, I think that is something that you're going to be hanging bridles on. Perhaps not collars, but reins and all the other tack.
Well, yeah, it certainly...
Yeah.
Makes sense.
These finds give us an idea of what it might have been like in the stables. But for military veterans, a project like this has a really special significance.
Actually learning about military history and thinking of what it would have been like to go to war back then, I don't know if I'd be able to have done it.
No.
You know, they did a lot for us.
My granddad was, paternal granddad, he fought in the First World War. So he was in the Second Battle of the Somme and he was at Ypres. And you just think, did he ever see any of the horses that were in these stables? There's a possibility they've come from here.
These stables would have been a last place of calm before the storm of battle. It's reasonable to assume that most of the horses sent from here to the front lines never returned home. But one horse's story of survival and heroism became a wartime legend, one that captured the nation's imagination. His name was Warrior.
When Warrior died in 1941, at the ripe old age of 33, he got a mention in the Evening Standard. The headline read, "The horse the Germans could not kill."
To learn more about him, I've come to the Animals in War Memorial in London.
Hello, Ruff.
Lovely to see you.
Lovely to meet you. And this must be Warrior.
This is Warrior. According to my grandfather, he won the war single-handed.
And that is your grandfather, sat on top of Warrior?
He was called Jack Seeley. He was a very much over-the-top figure, but very brave.
He wrote an account of his experience in the Great War.
Yes, in 1934, he bought a book out which had a modest title of My Horse Warrior. And it's a sort of love letter to him. It was a huge success at the time.
Unlike many horses sent into battle, Warrior was a trained charger, a thoroughbred, raised by Seeley to be the best of the best, a general's horse. Just 7 days after Britain declared war, he arrived in France to lead a cavalry brigade.
What does your grandfather write in his book about the adversities that Warrior had to go through?
He said there's always bullets around, rifle fire, which is always... Well, the head can kill a horse anyway. Then the shells landing, so you've got that. And then you've got mud. And, of course, pretty horrible, the smell of death.
You know, there's dead horses everywhere. Grandpa was prepared to put himself and his horse in the front line. The horse has to put trust in the person in charge, and the rider has a responsibility to look after it. And what's inspiring about those two was they did have the trust.
Even though he survived the war, Warrior's life constantly hung by a thread.
Twice the stable he was in got bombed and collapsed. He was caught in a fire and he jumped out. The horse next to him got killed. And the mother and passion nearly sank into that and they managed to pull him out.
Well, that's the thing, isn't it? Because Warrior is an exceptional horse, isn't he? He survived the Great War, but he offered so much inspiration to others on the battlefield.
From the first time they had a shell land near him, the horse would stiffen, but he would then stand. Soldiers, they could see this horse standing. And it's a bigger target than they are, and it's standing still, so they're not going to cower. He was a very brave horse, and therefore a very inspirational horse, because courage is and bravery is a very simple thing, and a brave horse is a very physical symbol of that. You know, big head, ears pricked, facing into danger. It's a great symbol. But I'm so thrilled now that the inspiration he was is now there for all to see.
After surviving the war, Warrior enjoyed the peace and tranquility of the Isle of Wight until his death in 1941. But his bravery was never forgotten. And on the centenary of the Great War, he was finally rewarded with a Dickin Medal, the animal equivalent of the Victoria Cross.
And here it is, resplendent in all of its glory. And it's also attached to this ribbon, which holds quite a lot of significance. It represents all of the armed forces. The green, which is the Royal Navy, this russet brown, which signifies the army, and the sky blue, which is the Royal Air Force. I find this medal really touching. It makes me just think of all of those animals, just like Warrior, going through all of those struggles and strifes and the hardships of war. It's such a fitting tribute.
Coming up, ground-penetrating radar reveals the full extent of Catterick's horse barracks.
And I find out firsthand about the technology that finally brought the days of the war horse to an end.
If a horse comes across something like this, there's really only going to be one winner.
World War I. Alongside the millions of soldiers in the trenches were an army of war horses. In Catterick, North Yorkshire, an archaeological team are searching for the stables where many of those animals were kept before being sent into battle. Using the latest geophysical technology, they're mapping out what structural remains might lie buried at the site. But they're facing an enemy of their own, the weather.
Hi, Peter, Lieberan.
Hi, Alex.
You managed to get a chance to dry out a little bit, are you?
Yes, we have.
It's actually soaking out there. Any nice surprises coming up?
We do have. We've been looking at another field down here.
Right.
Which we've only got a partial part of it on this plan.
Yep.
But what you can see is part of the riding school here, which would have been a gallery.
Yeah.
And what you see here is you can just see the outlines of it. And also further off the map, which you can't, we don't have a record of here,
yeah.
But you can see, you can start to see outlines of individual blocks here.
Right, yes.
And this is possibly another stable block, which is unknown.
I mean, that's what sort of geophys is all about, finding something that we didn't know was there in the first place. So hopefully then afterwards somebody can go and dig and see, you know, if it's what we think it is.
But this is an indication then that this stable complex, which we already think is really quite large, is in fact even bigger.
It's much bigger than we anticipated, yes.
Yeah.
It's clear that the 40,000 horses who passed through here were an indispensable part of the British Army. So why was this massive complex demolished? Throughout the war, the number of horses sent to the front line increased dramatically. But so too did the casualties. For the army, the loss of so many war horses could have spelt disaster.
But technology was on their side.
Towards the end of the First World War, if you heard the orders, cavalry, charge, you might not just hear the clatter of hundreds of horse hooves, you might also be presented with something like this.
The tank was Britain's top secret weapon, developed under the direction of one Winston Churchill. In September 1916, these iron monsters entered the battlefield for the first time.
Quite an impressive beast, this. Tell me about her.
Well, it's a replica of a Mark IV First World War tank. It's armoured with 12mm armour plate steel on the outside. It's got 5 Lewis machine guns. It's weighing in at 28 tonnes, but still only does 4 miles an hour.
So is this the point where we see that transition of war becoming mechanised in a way?
Yeah, and totally.
This is a seminal moment in history because for the past 2,500 years, humans have been using horses to try and act as the main military focus of manoeuvre and fighting. And this is a change. This is a really big change. This is really designed to make the breakthrough in the First World War.
It was built so the soldier could march behind it. 4 miles an hour, the soldier would be able to keep up with it, use it as some protection going across no man's land, hide behind it.
You imagine being that first person to see something like this on the battlefield. From a German perspective, you've got this very new thing.
Yeah. Well, the Germans nicknamed them fire-breathing dragons, you know, iron-cladded monsters. How do you deal with something like this? They're seeing their rifle bullets bounce off them.
So is this when we start seeing the horses being decommissioned?
They've realised that that's just not going to work. Old-style cavalry, it's not going to be a successful technique anymore. And if a horse comes across something like this, huge armoured vehicle, there's really only going to be one winner.
The arrival of the tank was a game-changer. For the first 3 years of the war, the Western Front had been locked in a stalemate, with neither side gaining ground. But once the British employed tanks on a mass scale, they began to breach enemy lines like never before. The days of British war horses leading the charge were over.
Although horses continued to fulfil a supply role, the army's demand for them reduced dramatically. As a result, the complex network of buildings here at Catterick could be demolished. Only now, a century on, are we getting clues to what it would have all looked like.
Hello, Alex.
How you doing, Alex? Good to see you again.
Well, look, apart from some horrendous weather, how have things developed in this trench?
We've had some great results this week since you were last here. You can see we've actually got down a lot deeper than we were.
Yeah.
And we can see it there, the large concrete block that runs across the centre.
Yeah.
And you can also see as well, we've actually got the original floor level.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
And we've completely changed, really, what we were thinking previously. Again, it's the foundations and the floor surfaces that are giving us the idea that this is not just temporary. This is not overnight here. They are literally, you know, making this to last.
Yeah.
The fabric, the cost of it, the way it is built, you know, look how thick the concrete is for this. This is not going away anytime soon.
Thanks to the hard work of Alex and the team, the dig has revealed a network of timber. Trenches, tanks, and troops.
About 8 million people from across the British Empire served in the First World War. Alongside them on the front lines were other largely forgotten heroes, the country's war horses.
And around 1 million of those brave animals were involved, carrying troops and supplies, hauling heavy weaponry, even leading the charge into battle. And as with their human comrades, the deaths and casualties were appalling. Over 250,000 fell on the Western Front alone.
Many of the horses that saw action would have spent time in places like the site that is the location for our latest dig.
The British Army's Catterick Garrison is in North Yorkshire, between Leeds and Newcastle. Following the outbreak of World War I, a huge complex of stable blocks and a horse hospital were built here to prepare the animals for their journey to the front line. Over a century on, nearly all the buildings have been lost to the soil. But now, archaeologists and military veterans are trying to uncover them. I'll be joining them in their search, but first, I need to